If the fruit is imperfect, we find its greater purpose. We find the value in it. And sometimes you have to look past, you know, the visual imperfections in the fruit to find the goodness inside. And that's how we end up making some of the most delicious beverages and some of the most delicious ingredients and food products, because we look past all of that and we seek out the good. And I think that it's very true in life.
Hi, it's Steph, and that was the voice of Sarah Fry. She is the author of a new book called The Growing Season: How I Built a New Life and Saved an American Farm. She's the owner and CEO of Fry Farms, grower and supplier of produce to some of America's giants in the retail industry. Think Walmart, Lowe's, Publix, Whole Foods, Target. She's also been called the Pumpkin Queen by some national media outlets, but she does pumpkins and so much more. With that kind of success, it might surprise you to learn that she grew up in rural poverty. She was raised on a struggling farm and used her imagination to see a brighter future for herself and for her brothers. In her book, you learn how her childhood ingrained in her a sense of self, courage, independence. Early chores, hunting for dinner after school, and chopping wood for heat were all realities she lived, and they shaped her into a tough, tenacious, and compassionate person, and a visionary and, might I add, fearless businesswoman. She offers some great perspective on the parallels between growing seasons on a farm and growing seasons in life. And during this pandemic, I know it's a perspective everyone will relate to. Am I right? I just want to give a quick shout out. If you are one of the kind souls who carved out some time and left a rating and or review of Another Door Opens on Apple Podcasts, I heart you. And if you feel compelled to share the episode with a friend, please also consider leaving a quick review and subscribing. It'll just help get more eyeballs and ears. I also want to send a virtual hug to my supporters on Patreon, who I appreciate so much. If you want to be a patron too, for as little as a dollar a month, you can check out some of the perks that go with that and log on to patreon.com/anotherdooropens. So let's get to the pumpkins and the melons and the business lessons and the life lessons, shall we? This is the Another Door Opens podcast, and I'm your host, Stephanie Hamango. Here is Sarah Fry. I just have to tell you, I am so thrilled to talk with you. I heard your book on Audible, and I was so excited when I discovered that you were actually reading your own book.
Aww. You know, that was no easy feat. I had a director, and she stopped me every, I don't know, I'd get through a paragraph, and she'd be like, okay, all right, can you go back now, repeat this sentence, put more emphasis on this word? It took 2 days to read that book.
Oh, man. But it came across so naturally. I can't imagine how difficult those are to do. But I love the way when you listen to a book narrated by the author on Audible, you really get a different level of meaning. Like, you can put the inflection as you intended it, as opposed to having a narrator, you know?
Right, right. I am glad that I did it myself now. When I was going through the process, I was cussing it. Just to be honest, I was like, this is really hard.
So I want to ask you a little bit about The Growing Season, How I Built a New Life and Saved an American Farm, your book, and other things too. I gather that farms can vary a lot. Can you paint a quick picture of the farm you grew up on as a young girl in Southern Illinois?
Sure. You know, Southern Illinois is closer to Kentucky than Chicago. A very rural area. When you get south of where, you know, Interstate 57 and Interstate 70 meet, the landscape changes. It's not the flat prairie land that people envision when they think of farmland in Illinois. You know, there are more rolling hills and more trees the further south you go. And where I grew up, it's one of the largest, if not the largest county in the state, but the least populated. It's actually quite beautiful. The hill, the farm that I grew up on, is it's a beautiful place. When I grew up, it was an old drafty farmhouse, and there were barns. There was one barn that was there when my parents purchased the farm, but the other barns the children built, like myself and my brothers built them. And there were old sheds and lots of fences and one of just about every animal that you can imagine. So if you think of the sort of idyllic, like, farm growing up with, you know, animals, that's kind of what we had. But then we also had all of these horses because, you know, of my father's race horse dream. And a big family. And, you know, we were such a big family, we didn't really get to go out much or really do a whole lot of anything. We stayed on the farm and there was just work every day, you know, day in and day out, which is not, was not unique to my childhood or this farm. I mean, there's always so much work. And when you have livestock or when you have animals growing up, I mean, they require a lot of attention, daily attention. We had an old smokehouse on the farm. We hunted, harvested, or grew pretty much everything that we ate, you know. It's really interesting, too, this time that we find ourselves in now in 2020, there's more of an emphasis on food, and people were buying fruits and vegetables in bulk, and they were learning how to can or how to, you know, process and freeze fresh food. And that's really how I grew up on this farm.
Looking back now, how do you think your upbringing on that farm equipped you with the values or qualities that would serve you as a really pioneering business owner and entrepreneur? And of those qualities, which among them do you think matter the most?
Oh, there were so many things. I mean, I think I learned to be persistent. I learned to find my courage. I learned how to survive. When there are a lot of things that you witness on the farm, a lot of really, you know, really incredible moments, like to watch a mare birthing a foal or to learn just sort of about life in a very visceral way. And I had a lot of really great experiences growing up with my older brothers. My siblings, you know, taught me a lot. And they were boys, you know, so I grew up with four older brothers and they probably helped so much with instilling that confidence in me and making me find my courage in a lot of ways and to be strong. And, you know, I hated being left behind. I loved having a big family and I hated being left behind by those boys. And I think that probably inspired me to want to do, you know, big things and to want to be courageous. So I think courage is probably one of the things, the traits and the qualities that I would point out. And I think that it wasn't unique to me or really even my upbringing. I think courage lives within all of us. It's just finding it. And I think growing up on the farm and in the way that I did, that those experiences helped me find my courage at such an early age.
You talk about hard times when you're growing up and starting to meet other kids and eventually go to other homes of other people and start to see how other people lived. When mm-hmm. you were growing up and before those moments that sort of opened your world to other ways of life, were you aware of poverty? Were you aware of lack? Or did you just feel like this is how people do life and we're good?
Yeah, I did. I was very happy. I was a very happy little girl because of the freedom that I had. I had a lot of freedom and I had, you know, freedom to be outside, freedom to run around, you know, play in the dirt. I was forced to have a big imagination, you know, and I didn't think there was anything abnormal about the way we were being raised, you know. And like you said, you know, when I started going to other people's homes and I'd look around, you know, I talk about the thermostat in the book. The first time I saw a thermostat, I thought, that's really fascinating. That little box controls the temperature. And I had to carry the wood in every morning and every night. That was my job. And to also cut the wood. And from the time I literally was old enough to carry a piece of wood, that was the job, you know. And I started looking at, you know, the modern technology and thinking, well, that was the thing for me, modern technology. That's when the switch flipped. Like, okay, why wouldn't we just get that? That doesn't look that complicated. You know, it doesn't look that hard. Why wouldn't we have a thermostat? And this would be so much easier if we just turned that little dial and magically heat was in our house. So that was probably one of my earliest memories of, okay, this is interesting. Not everyone cuts wood, you know, for a fire to stay warm. And then as I started to get older and then, you know, going to school and seeing how all of the other kids dressed and what the other little girls, what they wore, how they did their hair. And some of that too was my own fault because I think my mother probably tried to lay out clothes for me. She attempted to like have me dress a certain way. And to her credit, she did try, but I was probably a very difficult little girl because I had been raised in such a sort of wild way, like a weed, you know? And I didn't want to conform to the traditional, okay, you're going to pull your hair up in a bow and you're going to look pretty. Because I thought, well, I'm doing all of these boy things and these boys aren't having to, you know, make sure their hair is brushed perfectly and they're not putting bows in their hair. And, you know, why do I have to wear that shirt? That's, you know, stupid was like my favorite word when I was a little girl. That's stupid. Why would I do that? Like, but then, you know, at the older I got in grade school, then I realized, okay, not only are they dressing normally, they're having normal experiences. Their concerns are normal kid type concerns. The things that they're talking about in school, they're all very normal things. I'm the one that's not normal. First, second, third, fourth grade, I was thinking about, you know, financial concerns, my parents' financial concerns, you know, whether we were going to have a home, what we were going to have for dinner, knowing that when I got off of the school bus, we were going to have to go hunt and process whatever meat that we were going to go hunt for. My head was always back at the farm, even when I was in school around these normal kids. It was difficult for me. I had to like sort of fake being normal and fake being interested in what they were having conversations about, because as a little girl, I was always thinking about really sort of very, very raw survival type issues.
That is so fascinating because you look at that girl then and fast forward to now, Fry Farms, which you spearheaded, founded, and grew, which has become one of America's largest fresh fruit produce growers and shippers, right? Doing business with some of the largest vendors. Mm-hmm. Can you just give a quick glimpse of what types of produce and other items you're selling today?
Sure. The commodities that we sell are mainly like watermelons, cantaloupes, sweet corn, fresh tomatoes, pumpkins. This is probably what Fry Farms is best known for, all the pumpkins and hard squash that we grow. But we own and operate farms and facilities in 7 states now. So we start our season out generally in the southeast down in Florida. And then as the seasonality of the business changes, you know, then we move up into Georgia, Illinois, Indiana, Arkansas, Missouri, and we actually have a farm just outside of Washington, D.C., about an hour up in the panhandle of West Virginia. But we sell, you know, thousands and thousands of semi-loads of fresh produce every year, and that produce ends up at your favorite retailer. We do business with the top 25 retail chains in the country, everyone from, you know, Whole Foods to Walmart to Aldi, Target, I mean, anywhere you can buy fresh produce, generally, you'll find the Sarah's Homegrown brand there or the Fry Farms label. And then we also make beverages. So we make ingredients out of what is often referred to in our industry as the ugly fruit. And our beverages, retail beverages, can be found in the Southeast in the Publix grocery store chain. And then we also make a lot of beverages for the food service industry, too. And nationally, you can find our products at Subway. We make the watermelon cucumber agua fresca and the blackberry agua fresca at Subway.
Incredible. Incredible. Without revealing too much of what you describe in your book, and this is a big leap also, how did you go from seeing your childhood example of a farm to reimagining something so much bigger that has probably even surpassed your own early dreams and expectations?
I had a big imagination as a little girl, and I just keep going back to the foundation, you know, and thinking about the good things in my childhood and those really difficult experiences, actually, that ultimately I ended up extracting the good from and then applying them toward my life and my career and my business. But I have been so fortunate to be surrounded by love in my life, and even some of the most difficult things I wouldn't change about how and where I grew up and what I went through, because all of those experiences ultimately shaped me into the person that I am today and the person that I believe has made me a compassionate leader, a good human being, and, you know, someone that people want to work with and grow with. And I will say, like, in our company, as we've grown, I don't feel like we have employees. I feel like we have family members, and I'm from a big family. So it's like everybody that comes in and works with our company, they ultimately become part of this big family. So I think growing the business was very natural for me because of the human aspects of it as well. And the bigger we got, the more that we did, it was just like, the more people. And when I was a little girl, I loved being around people. I had a big family, and then I really enjoyed my time getting off of the farm in the summer and being able to go with my mom on that melon delivery route, not just because I loved to sell melons out of the back of a pickup truck. It was because I loved people and getting to engage and interact with others. So communication became very natural for me at an early age, because of my love of other humans and in human contact. So for me, I think so much of the success of the farm and the family and growing the business is really because of the human capital, that aspect of it. I've been so fortunate in my life to attract people into my orbit that are just really kind, good, salt of the earth, hardworking people that ultimately have been by my side and, you know, have helped me grow to the size and scale that we've grown, and continue to do that every day. There's still more that we can do. There's still more that we can do in the way of sustainability. There's still more in the way that we can do in the way of giving back. I'm very blessed to be surrounded by such great members of my work family too, and growing this business. I mean, yes, there was a fierce independent spirit that started it all, but I would have never been able to grow it without the love and the support of all of those who have surrounded me throughout the years that believed in the vision and stayed true to the mission.
Oh, I think that just says so much about your character, that you value people the way you do. And you alluded to something just a second ago about the ugly fruit. And that is something that really stood out to me in your book. When it comes to produce, every fruit, every growing season is not quote unquote perfect. And so you realized you can't purely put value in the perfect fruit or the perfect times, right? Can you explain your attraction to the imperfect, both in application to produce and to life?
I view the business very similar to life. And for me, it's all sort of all commingled. I don't feel like I go to a job every day. I feel like really what I've built, because it's work, it's family, it's kids, it's everything sort of all rolled into one. And we all know that life is imperfect, but we all know that it's also what you make of it, and how do you take those experiences that might not be good and learn from them and grow from them and apply those learnings to a better life in the future and maybe a better growing season. And it's the same with the fruit. I mean, there's fruit that's visually imperfect, but that doesn't mean that it's just bad and should be wasted, just like a life, right? So if your life is imperfect, should it be wasted? No, you have to find the good in it and also the greater purpose for that life. And that's what we do with the fruit. If the fruit is imperfect, we find its greater purpose. We find the value in it. And sometimes you have to look past, you know, the visual imperfections in the fruit to find the goodness inside. And that's how we end up making some of the most delicious beverages and some of the most delicious ingredients and food products, because we look past all of that and we seek out the good. And I think that it's very true in life. I mean, no one has a perfect life, right? And people go through really hard times, very difficult human growing seasons. And, you know, this year we've all been through, we're still kind of going through a very difficult human growing season, but there has been good. And when I think back on this last year in 2020, I could really focus on the bad. I could think about all the negative aspects of this last year in COVID on my family, on my life, and on my business. I choose to really focus on what good this very difficult growing season has brought us. And for me, that's been more time with my boys. I haven't been flying as much, clearly. I've been here with my children. I've had more dinners at home. I've had time. I've been given the gift of time with my kids to teach them, to really get to know them. They're teenagers now, and to bond with them and to develop an even closer, more fulfilling relationship with them. And the time that I've had to teach them about life, to teach them about business, to teach them about the things that we value, I would have never had that time before. So that's what I choose to focus on during this difficult growing season. And you know, it doesn't, in life or in business, it's kind of how you have to look at things. And ugly fruit is no different than having an imperfect life at times. And it really all comes down to, what do you do with that? Do you focus on the bad, or do you look for the good?
So I wanted to ask you, from your experience, what is the best way to navigate through a fallow or seemingly dormant time in life when you're putting in the work and you're not seeing the fruits of your labor? Do you feel like you answered that, or is there something more you'd like to add when framed up that way?
I think it's different. You know, I mean, it's different. Sometimes it's good to sort of just hunker down, and, you know, persistence is a big theme throughout the book, and never really giving up. And boy, I got to tell you, there are so many times in my life where I wanted to give up. And when things got really, really difficult, and even though you know, you can't see the light at the tunnel, it's that sort of belief, and it's holding out that hope that if you just keep going, that you will get through it. It's no different when, you know, it's really sort of the farmer's mentality. Farmers keep going out every year. A flood can destroy their crop. Too much rain, too little rain, a drought, insidious disease can wipe out crops. But the farmer's optimism is, you know, I'll do it again next year. And sometimes they continue to lose year after year after year, but then they'll get that one good growing season. And sometimes that's really all you need, is one good growing season to pull you out. And then you're back in the game and you're doing it over and over again. And I think when times get really tough and they get really challenging, sometimes you have to look a little harder for the good. But there's always good to be found. And we're always learning and we're always growing, no matter what we're going through. And I think that the more difficult times that we go through, that's actually probably when we have the best personal growth in our lives. You just know that when you come out on the other side, and sometimes that's what I have to think about, is just focus, just stay the course, keep doing what you're doing. You're going to get through this. And when you do, just imagine the feeling that you're going to have and how good it's going to be when you get on the other side. Sometimes that's hard to do, but if you can get it in your head, you know, and have yourself convinced that there will be a better season, you can get through anything.
Do you have any kind of mental reset button that you go to each day to sort of put that reminder front of mind for you? Or is it something that you've been practicing it so long it comes?
I think it's the practice of it. I've had to, you know, when I was a little girl, I had to do a lot of compartmentalizing. And I learned to do that, you know, at a very early age. And then I sort of had to deprogram myself from that too, in a sense. But as I got older, the more experiences that I had, the more I started to really witness and recognize that it's like why I never really got hung up on like seeking revenge, or why I was able to forgive easily, those things. Because I could always see, and if you pay attention, you can always see how things ultimately come around, you know, whatever it is, the loop always gets closed at some point. And the older I got, the more I started to understand and appreciate that. So I get a little less worked up about things. And that's sort of how I feel really now in my life, too. I think so much of that is because of the practice, but the older I get, the more mature I get, the more understanding I gain. I'm watching my nieces now grow up in the business, and they get really, you know, they get really worked up about things. And I tell them, you have to exercise patience during this time. And this is when you push on the gas. This is when you back off. You know, I'm sort of kind of coaching them through some of their own moments and their own, you know, kind of issues. And, you know, in the business, they're working in the business now. And I'm trying to impart this wisdom on them, but the difference is the age and the experience. And like you said, the practice of doing it so often that it just becomes normal.
You know, one thing I appreciated so much, I mean, there's so much wisdom in your book and there's so much vulnerability, but it also reveals so much grit and also humor. I'm going to just allude to something here so that the readers don't have a giveaway, but I want to sort of go to the subject of the golden sunset and the harvest moon. And so
this is a great story.
Yeah, it's a great story. You know what?
I have a photo of that. Just so you know. I couldn't share it in the book. Oh yeah, totally. I totally have a picture.
I will say it was quite vivid, and even without a photograph, I got it. So we're talking in October and pumpkins are everywhere right now. I have one sitting next to me just because I thought that would feel good while talking to you. And,
yes.
When you started to think about growing pumpkins, because that wasn't something right out of the gate that you did, what did you need to learn anew about crop science, if anything, to make that happen?
Oh, I had to learn everything. Are you kidding me? I had to learn it all. You know, pumpkins, actually, I got lucky because the farm here in southern Illinois was a clay-type soil that was, you know, rolling hills, and so there was some good drainage. So the original farm that I grew up on actually had, you know, soil that was conducive to growing cucurbits. And so in that sense, that was good. But I had to learn about weed control. That was probably one of the biggest things that I challenges that I faced when I first started growing pumpkins. But I had to learn everything. I had to learn about plant diseases and, you know, certain things that affect that crop, you know, that would normally affect a row crop like corn and soybeans. So there was a lot of learning. And and we're still learning. I mean, I feel like I have to learn something new every day. I think it's important that we all learn things, new things every day, so we keep, you know, growing. But we still don't have it all figured out just yet. It was certainly an experience, and starting from scratch, and then, you know, growing, just starting out small and then growing more and more every year, and continuing to learn. And there have been so much progress made too, and the different seed varieties that we grow now with all of the commodities, not just pumpkins, but with everything that we grow. And that makes things a little bit easier, as well as varietals improve. And some of the varieties that we grow have, you know, are disease resistant. And that all happens through plant breeding programs, which is fantastic for not just the farmer, but also for the planet, because that means that you have to spray things less and you're not having to add things to a crop that aren't absolutely necessary.
I think there is something so calming about standing in a pumpkin patch and looking out over a pumpkin patch. What was it like the first time you looked out over your very first pumpkin patch?
Oh my gosh, I remember this moment so vividly. And I had spent a lot of time working in the pumpkin patch to try to keep the weeds at bay. And I remember joy. For me, it was almost like standing there in a field alone, but hearing children laugh. That's how I would describe it, being completely alone in the middle of a field, but hearing the joyous laughter of children all around me. And it took me back to some of the happier moments in my childhood. And it was, to me, what anyone's childhood should be like, that feeling. You know what I mean?
Mm-hmm.
So I was hooked. That's when the pumpkin became my favorite crop to grow. And it just represented happiness and joy. And that's when I decided that it was, this was going to be the thing that I would do and do well. And I would want to share that joy with the world.
Can you share maybe 3 to 5 fun facts about pumpkins?
I will share probably one of the most important facts, and that is we are the only country in the world that doesn't consume pumpkin almost daily.
Really?
Yes. So pumpkins are so popular in other parts of the world that the pumpkin, let's take Australia, for example. The pumpkin in Australia, they grow this really beautiful bluish-green pumpkin, which we grow here in America as well. We just don't know yet that we can eat them. It's called the Jardel pumpkin. Eating pumpkin in Australia is just as common as eating a potato in America. They have it just as often. And normally, pumpkin around the world, is another fact, pumpkin around the world, not only is it consumed very often in other parts of the world, it's rarely used in sweet dishes. So we think of pumpkin, we think of pumpkin lattes, pumpkin pies, pumpkin rolls, pumpkin dessert. But most other countries that eat pumpkin often, they think of it more as a savory side item. So it shows up in soups, it shows up in stews. So if I was making dinner tonight and I was Australian, I would probably chop up my pumpkin and put it in the crock pot with my roast instead of potatoes.
That's fascinating. Okay, you mentioned this other type of pumpkin. It's blue. How many types of pumpkins are there?
There are hundreds and maybe even probably thousands of varieties. I think there's probably well over 1,000 varieties of pumpkins. So we grow pumpkins from seed source from around the world. So we also grow this really beautiful kind of a bluish green pumpkin called the Marina di Sciaga, which is an Italian coastal pumpkin. Pumpkin is consumed on islands all over the world as well. And there are different varieties that grow in the more humid sort of island type climates. There are pumpkins that grow in South and Central America that are, they don't look like our normal orange jack-o'-lantern, but there are thousands of varieties. We probably grow well over 100 different varieties. There's a beautiful French pumpkin that we grow that makes like delicious pies. My favorite visually and taste is still that sort of bluish green Jardel pumpkin. It has sort of a nutty flavor to it, but I love them all and they're all good for different things. But if you want different flavors, different textures, depending on the dish that you're making, there's a pumpkin that we refer to as the peanut pumpkin. It looks like it has peanuts growing all over the outside of it. Mm-hmm. It actually makes the most incredible, sweet dishes. For the savory dishes, I really I like that Italian pumpkin, and I love the Australian pumpkin for the savory dishes. But they all taste fantastic. I mean, they're gorgeous. They come in all of these different shapes, sizes, textures, and colors. And for me, when I think of pumpkins, I don't just see an orange pumpkin. I see all of these different varieties of pumpkins in my mind.
I love that. Before I ask you my final question, I just want to ask you where people can find your book, The Growing Season, and where they can find and follow you on social media.
So the book can be found online at walmart.com or amazon.com. It's also at Barnes & Noble, and there are many independent bookstores now that have picked up The Growing Season. I'm very excited about that.
Great.
And you can also download the audio version, which is, I actually read the book, so you can hear it, the story told in my voice. And if you want to join along, and please reach out to me, let me know what you think of the story at Sarah Fry on Instagram. It's just at Sarah with an H, S-A-R-A-H, Fry, F-R-E-Y.
Awesome. Final question, which I ask everybody, what do the words another door opens mean to you, if anything?
It means to me that when you get let down about something or something doesn't work out the way that maybe you had originally intended, there's always another door that opens. And sometimes it's meant to be.
Before I share a story of another door opening in my own life, which I'll sometimes do at the end of a podcast, I want to say thank you to you for being here with me during this very strange time in the world and for lending an ear. And Sarah Fry, thank you for being my guest today. I will be watching for your pumpkin labels as I shop in the coming weeks, and I would love to come check out your farm someday. The pictures you post on Instagram are definitely inviting and make a person want to see it. Visit Sarah's website at fryfarms.com. That's F-R-E-Y farms.com. And follow her on Instagram at Sarah Fry. That's S-A-R-A-H-F-R-E-Y. And at Fry Farms. Also, get her book. I know you're going to get a lot out of it. There's a whole bunch to learn. There's so many sub-stories and there's so much substance. Again, it's called The Growing Season, How I Built a New Life, and Saved an American Farm. And all of that info will be in the show notes as well. A very special thanks to Eric Brown for the Another Door Opens drumbeat soundtrack. On Instagram, Facebook, and Twitter, please follow us at podcastado. That's at podcastado. Ready for today's short story? Okay, today's very short story is October-centric. I was born on Halloween. The end. I mean, birth. That's pretty much the ultimate example of a door opening for each of us, isn't it? This season, let's do more treats than tricks. Let's remember that our own fallow season or growing season doesn't necessarily coincide with that of our neighbor. So let's look out for each other and let's stay strong. Let's step up and do the right thing. Let's be good to each other and maybe enjoy a happy pumpkin, whether you cup it, sip it, or carve it. Oh, and carve out some time for self-care too. That's the Another Door Opens podcast for this week. Thank you for being here. I'll see you next time. Love you. Bye.